You know who the Pashtuns are?
Yeah.
The Pashtuns are the Taliban fighters. They're wonderful people. We villainize people and we start making hate talk and hate speech and we don't know what to think. The people of India are wonderful people. They're very hospitable people. They're very loving people. The Pashtuns, there's 40 million of them. They believe that the descendant, that they are the Ephraimites. They were exiled from Israel back in 760 AD. They've been living in the mountains in northern Iraq and between Iraq and Iran, and then on over in the beyond those mountain ridges and the mountains that lie west of Afghanistan and Pakistan, down into the Kashmir Valley. Look at it on the map. The Kashmir Valley is supposed to be one of the most beautiful places on the planet. And everybody's afraid of it. And it, you know what? The Holy Ghost did not create one bit of that fear. That's a demonic prison trying to keep everybody out. And we're getting ready to go there, and I want you to begin to quit. I want you to begin to, if you don't like the Pashtuns, I want you to begin to start liking them. So you say, let's go kill them all. Why don't we go save them all? Why don't we go love on them? Somebody said, oh, we need to get rid of all the immigrants. I want them all to come. My forefathers came here to these shores as a bastion, that this would be a lighthouse to the world, to the nations, a bastion of the kingdom of God, to open up our arms to everybody who wanted to come. And that's a change. Somebody said, how about the immigrants? I love them all. I don't want anybody to go. I'm an immigrant. Just about everybody here is an immigrant. Amen. I was with a dear brother the other night that's not an immigrant. He's the grand chief of the Cree Nation. His father's been chief since they came over on the land bridge or however they came over. So many, you know, who knows, 3,000 years ago, 4,000 years ago, 5,000 years ago, I don't know. People come, get everything all set up for themselves, and then they want to shut the door so nobody else can come. What's up with that? I believe that if we opened up our arms and started focusing faith on a great outpouring of the Holy Ghost instead of all this fear and hate and finger-pointing and accusation stuff, I just don't even believe. I can't even understand how God's people full of the Holy Ghost even get caught up in it. Somehow they got sidetracked. Come on, man. What are we supposed to be doing? You know what? What goes on is one, listen, 1 in 100 million go. You with me? Yeah. Basically, 1 in 100 million go, and everybody sits home afraid. I'm going to go. I would love for them to come. Come on to the shores. Let's have a Holy Ghost revival. Of course, we'll have to have a church full of faith in the Holy Ghost. Do that.
Hallelujah.
Huh? Because I can tell you about all. I'm going to tell you right now, somebody said, what about ISIS? They already here. Somebody said, what about this one? What about that one? They're already here. The only remedy is the Holy Ghost revival. People, we've already been through this. We've already been through this 100, for 200 years, for 300 years. We've already been through this stuff. We've already gone from one phase to another phase to another phase. And praise God that there was a church full of the Holy Ghost. There was a church that would believe in the love of God and being able to see Christ Jesus shake a nation. He lives. He lives. Come on. He lives to heal. He lives to deliver. He lives to save. Come on. I mean, the church ought to be standing on the shores with arms wide open saying to Syrian refugees, come right on, we'll just lead you right into the church. We'll fill the church up. Instead of sitting around in fear, perfect love casts out all fear. I just, you know, when I see Muslims, I recognize the prince of the power of the air trying to create a hate zone around them. Man, I tell you, I just break through that and just love on them. Come on, man. Just go out of my way to help them. You need to as well. Come on, people. Where's the church? Come on, where's the church? Somebody said, at what cost will we do this? What do you mean at what cost? God so loved the world, He gave His only begotten Son and told us to go do the same. At what cost? What are you talking about? What cost? I mean, what makes you more right and more able to enjoy these things that God, through Christ Jesus, has blessed us with? Not by your own arm, not by your own power, not by military might. We was never supposed to have a standing army in this nation anyways. Uh-oh. We were never ever supposed to ever have these things. It was not part of the idea. It was not part of protecting the church so that the church could run to the nations of the earth with the gospel. It was not part of the idea. The idea has been hijacked. And then I watch as God's people all caught up in this new spin off the idea. Political scientists have said that the Constitution of the United States of America is a genius event that happens with a probability of maybe once every 3,000 years. No, it was an idea that took place in a Holy Ghost revival, and God made a way in the midst of the governments of men to protect the church. Hallelujah. Oh, just go examine a little bit. How many political scientists do we have here? I mean, some of them are, huh? We've got doctor of political science here, another doctor of political science upstairs. Look, I'm telling you right now, there's all different kinds of ways to view things. We just view it through the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. We view it through the word of God. What does God say? Hallelujah. I'm willing to go. Listen, come on. Somebody said, this thing, that thing. I said, praise God for Obama. I didn't vote for him. I despise just about everything he did in many respects. But you know what he did for me? You know what he did for you? You know what he did for the church? He opened up Cuba. We're doing a crusade in Havana, Cuba this year. Hallelujah. Come on now. Come on now. Somebody said, what are you doing? I don't care how big your church is. We're doing things by the grace of God that nobody on the planet is doing. That's what we're doing. We're going to go into Havana, and we're going to have the first mass evangelism crusade in the history of the nation. Amen. Why? Because of Obama. Ha! God uses the most unlikely people sometimes. Hallelujah. Ha, ha, ha. Praise God. I just jump around and get excited about it. No, it's so much easier to go and preach in places where you've got to risk your life when America and the West isn't hostile against them. You listening to me? I just pray that all God's people go someplace where you got to risk their life. Somebody said, I went to Port-au-Prince. You're not going to risk your life in Port-au-Prince. Give me a break. Go to North Korea. Go to Kashmir. Go to Afghanistan. Go to Iran. Go to Benghazi, Libya. All I'm interested in is politics that gets me into the unreached people groups, because there's 3 billion people who have never heard the gospel, and that ain't right. And all I want to do is use all my influence and all my resources to get to them, and that includes my government. I pray in the name of Jesus, if you're watching me by web, you're listening to me in this room, that you'll change your political view on the world. And you'll get a kingdom of God view of the world. And you'll shut out all of this spin and all of this propaganda that goes on to serve the interest of an economic ideology or a political ideology. Let's get into the kingdom of God. Somebody said to me, anthropologist said, you guys need to stay out of Iri and Jai and leave those people alone. Give me a break. What are you saying that? Oh, they don't need to be westernized alone. I didn't come to westernize them. I came to kingdom of God-ize them. I came to get them into the kingdom of God. I didn't come teach them about America and the West and all our values. I mean, get rid of it. Get rid of it. Get rid of it. Somebody says, you anti-American? No. I love my nation. I love what my ancestors did when they came here in 1610, 1620. I love what's going on. From the kingdom of God perspective, I don't love all the rest of the stuff where evil men get involved. Evil men are always going to get involved. You can focus on what the evil men are doing, or you can focus on what God's people are doing.
Hallelujah.
If you focus on what evil men are doing, you're going to have a whole set of beliefs out of that. If you focus on what God's people are doing in the kingdom of God, you're going to have yet a whole nother set of beliefs. If you're focusing on what's going on earth from a vantage point of heaven, you're going to view things very differently than if you're a person who loves God and you're focused on a vantage point of earthly, of that which is earthly, and trying to view everything from an earthly perspective. I want Japan to be rocked by the power of God. We had an opportunity, but the politics got bigger than the purpose of the kingdom of God. Praise God. General MacArthur said, send me your missionaries. Something happened. We could have transformed Japan. We had a window of opportunity. Japan could have been transformed. Right now, it's the most unreached people group that is a free society on the planet. I came out of a church in Osaka. We had just been in Tokyo and ministering for a week, and we went to Osaka. And while I was in Osaka, I went out on the streets of Osaka and I started just evangelize a little bit. And somebody said, "Hey, you can't do that here." An elder came from the church and said, "You can't do that here." I said, "Why?" He said, "It's an unwritten law." I looked at him, I started laughing. I said, "You gotta be kidding me, man. You believe that?" And then this same guy said, "Listen, I got a word of knowledge for that person right here. I'm telling you, listen, go tell this person such and such and such," and they'll stand there and start crying because you just read their mail. And he looks at me and said, "How can you do that?" I said, "I can do that because I love them. I could do that because I want to reach them. I don't do that out of some kind of idea of some gifting for my own cause or purpose. It's about the keys to their heart to unlock the door of the prison that they've been living in. We bombed them, man. Hello? We bombed them. Hiroshima and Nagasaki, we bombed them. And now I'm going to come and tell them I love them. It's tough, but we're going to break through. We're going to see Japan shaken by the power of God. I can't help it. We missed a great opportunity. And we keep repeating our history. And here we are once again with all this hate language. And I want somebody that's got some integrity in the White House. I don't care. I just want some integrity. Can somebody start making, can we begin to get on our knees and believe that somebody would start making decisions not based upon politics or based upon economics, but would begin to make decisions that would be about us being able to go reach the lost and love on people and realize that if we'll do that, God will protect us. Somebody said, "How about our safety? How about our national security?" My goodness, you start doing what God tells you to do, you're going to have some national security on a level you never thought possible. Come on.
It's true.
When God's on your side. Uh-oh. Uh-oh. When God's on your side. When angels fighting with you. When God did. When we did an unprecedented thing in the nation of Nepal, when God awakened a nation and God allowed us to be a part of that. And the Maoists told me, they said, "We are going to kill you. You listen to me. We will kill you. We will kill everyone that comes with you. We will kill everyone on the ground." There are people watching this right now that are watching by web and YouTube that can say that is true. I was there. I'm an eyewitness. I'm an ear witness to it. That are in Norway right now, some are in Nepal right now, some are in India right now, the eyewitnesses to it, some of them are in America right now. I'm not making this up. This is not some exaggeration. I'm not trying to win some kind of, new status or anything. I'm just telling you what it was. I want to make a point to you. They said, "We're going to kill you. We're going to kill everyone with you. They're the Maoists. They're the Communist Party of Nepal." No, we're supposed to hate the communists, right? Jesus. You know what happened to the Maoists? They became my best friends. They're my best friends today. They take care of me. They take care of me. They showed their act of solidarity. And while we were there, they showed their act of solidarity that they could control Nepal. And they shut all of the highways and roadways down in Nepal. All of them. There was one van moving, the one that Ann and I was in. There's a couple of other people that were in that van. Who else is in here that was in that van? There's two people that were in that van right there. We were the only car moving. Why? Because God's on our side. We came to love on a nation. We came to lay down our life. Give it a try. Do your worst. Give it your best shot. I said that in my spirit. I didn't say that to them. The general, the most famous general of the Maoist army, who had just died at the latter part of the 40-year war, the most famous general. His wife and his mother, both of them, fell in love with me. They took me into Parliament. They took me into the Ministry of Interior. They took me into the Ministry of Agriculture. They said, "Whatever you want. We want to give you 300 hectares of land." You know, the Lord told me I couldn't take it. I couldn't be beholding to them in any way. But nonetheless, I just want to tell you, the Lord gives us peace with our enemies. When we start doing this way, all of a sudden we don't have to go to war. You know how many people walked out of this church when I said that it's an evil, demonic thing that we're doing in Baghdad and Iraq? Yeah. You know how many people hated me because of that? But you know what my position was? I had received approval from Saddam to do a national crusade in Baghdad in 2002. They ruined everything. We were all over the Middle East. God was opening up doors. There was such a welcoming of God's, of the message of the gospel by the people of the Middle East. It had been a breakthrough after the last great upheaval, the great big upheaval in the 14th and the 15th century. Oh, God. I said, this is going to set missions back 50 years. You don't understand.
What I didn't realize, I was being overly generous. I just didn't want to say it would set it back bigger because I didn't want to be speaking anything out of my mouth to make it worse. But we're going to preach in Benghazi, Libya. We're going to have a national crusade in Benghazi, Libya. We're going to preach in Mecca, Saudi Arabia. We're going to preach in Damascus, Syria. Hallelujah. We're going to have a mass evangelism crusade in Tehran, Iran. It's coming back around. We're going to have a mass evangelism crusade in Baghdad, Iraq. It's going to happen again. We're going to bring it back around. We got to get out of it. We focus our faith, and it somehow gets on the wrong things, and it becomes, it's really something that can't be honored by God because it's just totally distracted in another place. It's not about reaching the lost and making disciples out of nations. It's about protectionism. It's about ideologies that belong to the world of evil men and not to the kingdom of God. I pray you just get down on your knees and begin to pray for the pastions. I'm going. We're going in May. We're going in May. And what? I was just with a dear brother. They just had a crusade in Pakistan. And it is amazing what happened. Pakistan has been building and building, but now they just had a crusade in Pakistan where they had 25 acres jam-packed with people, and it may be somewhere, it's estimated there was almost 1 million people gathered together. It's the cousins of Sariq. It's amazing. I just pray that you become, I pray that you become today more kingdom of God people with a greater vision for a lost and dying world, that all of a sudden you begin to process and think from the scripture instead of something somebody told you on CNN, somebody told you on the spin media, somebody told you from the aisles of conspiracy theories that have no end. There's a conspiracy theory that you not even hear. That your imagination in somebody else's mind and somehow it's infected you. There's something for everything. You know what I'm saying? Huh? Let's just start looking at the world. Let's get a worldview. You know, actually, when you talk about this, in the Old Testament, there is no word for mind. It doesn't exist. There is no Hebrew word for mind. It doesn't exist. Anytime you see in your translation the word mind, it was either translated from a word we call ruach, which is spirit, or a word we call nefesh, which is soul, or a word we call chai, which is life. It just depends on the context, because some people wouldn't understand if you said, do it with all of your soul. They might understand it, do it with all your mind. Or his soul was set on doing such a thing. It would be rather his mind was set on doing such a thing. Okay, you with me? Yeah. So mind became something that then began to be breaking down, as it were, more of distinctiveness of the things about the way men processes from a Greek perspective. Okay? Because Greek has several words for mind. One of the big ones is nous. So I can teach you a Greek word today, okay? Yes. Noose, like put your neck in a noose, right? Are you with me? Yes. Noose, that means mine. Phaneroo is another word. A couple of words for Greek in the Greek language for mine. Mind really is about your world perspective, your worldview. Did you know that? That's really what it is. That's what the biblical concept of mind is. It's your worldview. Huh? Somebody said, well, we're getting our mind renewed. You need to go ahead and get that done. Because Romans chapter 12 and verse 2, in Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 23, is talking about what event of regeneration. Not some third and fourth work of grace. Somebody all upset because, you know, Wesley had a second work of grace. You know, that now he's going to make a second work of grace, something that the cross didn't take care of, that you have to get to by a certain level. Now that's called sanctification. Well, that's no big deal. We got third and fourth and fifth works of grace now, that the way I perceive it in our modern theology, which has, because we've so drifted from the anchor of proper theological evaluation of things. When I say theological, I'm saying proper investigation of the scripture to have a foundation and a solid basis to ultimately derive some kind of conclusion about what's being said. There, people just don't study enough. They had a lot less and did a whole lot more with it 100 years ago. I'm sorry to say it. You know what? They didn't have the distraction of TV. They were sitting down reading the Bible in Hebrew and Greek and Latin and a few other languages. Are you listening to me? These people gave themselves continually to the Word of God. So they didn't drift very far. Now, we just basically got little pieces of information and we just go wild with it because we don't have a responsibility as much as we did, number one, to peer review and evaluation of leadership and eldership around us. We could just go down the road over here and start up some church in the name of Jesus and start saying, you know, that everybody who saves, their hair turns pink. And there are some people that are, I don't know, man. I'm just trying to come up with some wild thing to try to make my point. But Father has given us a new worldview. Amen. It's that we're in charge. Yeah. It's that we're in charge. Amen. Under Christ Jesus' leadership, we are in charge, and whatever we bind on earth, he'll bind in heaven. Hallelujah. Whatever we loose on earth, he'll loose in heaven. That he's given us the authority as the sons of God to go on all the world and preach the gospel to every creature, and those that believe will be saved. Hallelujah. The power and the authority of his name. There is no place that the power and the authority of the name of Jesus is so realized except for in a believer whose life is sold out to God. Oh, the name becomes so powerful through them. When I was in Japan and in Tokyo, and on the same trip I was talking about it when I was in Osaka, I was on the highest building, one of the highest floors, the tallest building, as far as it goes for hotels, 47th floor, large city. And I said to the Lord, Lord, you look very small here in this nation. Tokyo, you know, the largest city in the world. It didn't have that many churches in proportion to 26 to 27 million people. And the churches are very small, 30, 40 people average. And that morning at 5 o'clock in the morning, when all of Asia is praying, it's just kind of a thing, especially in China, all Asia is praying at 5 o'clock in the morning. I got woke up at 5 o'clock in the morning and the Spirit of the Lord spoke to me and said, Jesus speaking so loud to me in a dream. All authority is given to me in heaven and earth, Mark. And I'm looking for someone to agree with me. Because we can believe it. We can say, all authority is given to him in heaven and earth. God parted the sea, and they all went over dry land. And Joshua told the sun and the moon to stand still. And, Jesus is coming back in the future. And he's going to slay the nations with the sword of his mouth. And we'll have faith for the past. And we'll have faith for the future. But how about faith for right this moment, now, in this time? Because people, we get an option. We get an option to live big in the kingdom of God. But we're going to have to make that more important to us than anything else. The kingdom of God is going to have to be more important to us than anything else. Doing the will of the Father is going to have to be doing more important to us than anything else. Being who Christ Jesus said we are is going to have to be more important to us than anything else. Otherwise, we abdicate and we get to just live mediocre, you know, normalized and marginalized lives as the greatest race. We're the greatest race. Listen to me. When you come into the kingdom, you become part of a new race. Somebody said, you're Anglo, I'm Hispanic, or I'm Asian, or I'm this. You are. Why don't you come in the kingdom of God? Become part of a new race. God the Father, God Almighty becomes your father. Jesus Christ becomes your elder brother. You know, when God called Abraham out, that moment in time when Abraham was willing to go with God, a new race was born. And we call them Jews now because of what happened during their exile of the southern kingdom. When Judea and Jerusalem was exiled because of their sin and iniquity in Babylon, they began to be called Jews. Before they were just Israelites, another nation. Hey, when Jesus Christ came and died at Calvary's cross and went down into the belly of the earth and rose up out of the earth with keys of death and hell, and over all the grave and ascend up on high. He made a new race of people, a new race, kingdom of God people, family of God people, family of God, not Hindi, not from Kerala. You can be from Kerala, but you're not Hindi. You're kingdom of God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You're kingdom of God. Hallelujah. I was just with a great man of God from India. Young man, amazing young man, tall guy from northern India. His father has raised up over 800 churches across India. And he heard that I was going to Kashmir and he just starts crying. I want to go. Please, can I go? He's coming. I mean, he's doing everything he can do to come. It is so beautiful. He's not Hindi. He's kingdom of God. We got the same heart, the same vision, the same mind, the same spirit. Hallelujah. Coach, stop. If God's church would be who we were or supposed to be, we would lead the world in the complete eradication of prejudices. Huh? Because we would see because we would be a new race made up of all the families of the earth, of all tribes and of all nations and of all kindreds and of all people. There wouldn't be these great crazy divisions that exist within a world that is at war against itself. See, it's a worldview that creates that. It's a cultural thing that creates that. There's no question about it. It's a cultural thing. It's a caste system. We're gonna have to come over here and just begin to be taught by God the Holy Ghost, who's going to first teach us right out of the Word of God, clearly show us how to get filled with the love of Jesus, hallelujah, how to get filled with the mercy of God, how to get filled with the goodness of God, how to begin to love all men, how to begin to lay down our life for the church as well as for the entire world. It begins to shape a whole new dimension of thinking and processing. Somebody said to me, not too long ago, said, Ryan, you don't even have your own opinion. You always process things through the Scripture. And, you know, I'm like, whether it's meant to be an insult or not, I'm like, thank you very much. That's like the best thing anybody's told me, you know. Thank you. Because that's what I want to do. I want to process everything through the Scripture and make my decisions based upon what God said, because He's smarter than I am. I'm just His servant. I'm going with Master. Master's told me. I'm going with what the ruler says. He knows all things. Hallelujah. He has all knowledge. I want to come to understand how to move in spirit knowledge. Spirit knowledge will speak to the rock and water will come out.
Yes.
Spirit knowledge will say to the sun and moon, stand still, we're not done yet. The day can't end yet. I'm still busy today. Ha! Doing the kingdom of God business. Spirit knowledge, it'll say to the axe head, float. Whew. Spirit knowledge will say to the oil and to the flour, you can't diminish. It's a spirit knowledge. See, when you read Proverbs and you read about getting knowledge and getting understanding and getting wisdom, God's talking about you and I getting spirit knowledge, knowing how it is that God's doing it. And when we look in 2 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 5, the Lord tells us about this word, this Greek word, and it's called logismos. And logismos, we translate it imaginations, but it works that way. But we don't think of it really on our day-to-day lives as imaginations. We think of it as logical, rational thinking. And actually, logismos means logical, rational thinking. But what if you had to make that equal to imaginations? Uh-oh. And where those imaginations come from? You were equipped to have great imaginations beginning in preschool, and it was really solidified if you went on into undergrad, and my goodness, you received the full lobotomy at graduate school, you understand? To just be crazy, have crazy imaginations. It's true. It's true. Huh? Hello. Somebody said, are you anti-school? No. If I was, I mean, there would be hardly anybody left in here, because most people, you know, and so many people in this community, you know, are really involved in academics. I'm anti-intellectualism. I'm anti-relying on your own thinking, on your own way. I want spirit knowledge. Let's go for spirit knowledge. Logizomo there in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 5. It says, cast down your logics and your rational thinking. Ouch! What? Well, we might drive off the road if we do that. No. No, your arguments that are against the knowledge of Jesus, your arguments that are against speaking to the rock so the water comes out, making the sea a pathway to walk on during the midst of the storm. Hallelujah. How do I get into that? Well, Peter had the insight how to get into that. He said, Jesus, speak the word only. And I'll master the physical realm too. I'll speak the word only. I'm listening to hear you speak. If I hear you speak and you call me to come. See, I'm listening for spirit knowledge. Hallelujah. I just understand I'm loaded for bear. I was in a meeting here this past week. I wanted to get to this point, and I couldn't ever get to this point because too much foundation's got to be laid before people can hear this. But you're at that point. I just want to tell you about these things. I want to unload on you here this morning something I'm just so filled up with and that God's waiting for his people to step into. All you got to do is speak the word. Just speak the word to me. And I'll do it too. I'll move over in that realm. But what's going to happen? Logizomo is going to kick in and you're going to say, what am I doing out here? Huh? What is Logizomo going to do? It's going to cause the fear. Huh? Yeah. You're going to, Logizomo is going to go, wait a minute. We were just basically hanging on for dear life back in the boat thinking we're all going to die, right? And now I'm out here. I got somehow so drunk in the Holy Ghost, so caught away with the Word of God, so out there liberated with the mind of Christ, huh? That I'm out here in the midst of everything that I was afraid of and everything that was threatening me and looking at the boisterous wind and the waves. And he suddenly began to sink because of Logizomo. And so the Lord says, cast that stuff down. There's a spirit knowledge. There's a heavenly realm. There's a looking unto Christ Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. There's this mind of Christ. There's this mind of the Spirit that is ours. It's been given to us. The carnal mind, the unredeemed mind, is hostile against God. I can't believe that people actually have a theology where they go back and forth from a mind hostile against God, the enemy of God, to a mind now that's one with God. I'm like, give me a break. Where that doesn't make any biblical sense at all. Give me a break. I can understand the challenges of rational, you know, logical processing and thinking, messing with the program, but not a hostile demonic mind. You know what I'm saying? That Paul talked about in Romans chapter 8 and verse 7 and 8. You with me? That so many people make as a part of the Christian life that you and I are war against. No wonder. You can't go fight for the kingdom of God. You having a battlefield right there with yourself in your own living room. And you're never going to get the war done because you don't have faith to conquer that war. Because faith comes by the word of God. You have no empowerment to conquer that war. It's only believing what God says in his word that we have authority and power and heavenly backup. Yes. And I hate to use the word backup. But I mean, it's because he does more than back us up. He comes in, fills us up, and overtakes the situation when we agree with him. Just like Jesus said, I have all authority in earth. Do you know it's hard to believe that? Logizomos will not let you believe that. You with me? Logizomos will not allow you to believe that Jesus has all authority in heaven. I mean, forgive me. He don't have all authority in heaven. But that Jesus has all authority in earth. Because you're going to look around and you're going to quantitate and you're going to say, well, what about this and why about that? And financial kingdom and this kingdom and that kingdom and this problem, and that problem. If he had all authority in earth, then that wouldn't be going on. You know what? You're processing wrong. You're thinking wrong. And you're sinking. And unfortunately, you don't know you're sinking, so you don't scream out and go, help me, Lord Jesus. You with me? Yes. That Peter knew exactly where he was. He starts sinking and he's like, I'm going to drown. Help me, Lord. And immediately, whew, you know, it's so beautiful to get out there because not only did he get to walk on the water, but he got to experience being translated. Immediately, they were back in the boat. Remember? Translation. He got walk on water, translation, everything, just because he got so caught away with the amazing works of Jesus. You know, when I read the Bible, son, when I read the Bible, I get so caught away with the works of Jesus. I just go, bid me come. I want to do that. Why should I live my life like a mere man when I have been empowered by God to be one who demonstrates the kingdom, to be one in whom God lives, whom Christ Jesus reveals himself? What a life!
But we've got to break past all kinds of barriers, barriers that have been imposed upon us by church, by ministry, by leadership. Not only, and that's the worst kind, but also all the other kind within our cultural system that brainwashed us to believe the things that we believe about ourselves. You say, I wasn't brainwashed. I just believe whatever I choose to believe. No, you don't. All your imaginations, your thinking is based upon what you were taught, what people showed you to be true or wrong. All those F's on that paper did a big, huge work in you. You know what it did? You know, it just kind of made you feel bad about yourself. Remember that? That's the trick. Made you feel bad? Okay, now you're going to start listening to what we say. You're going to start working harder at getting what we tell you is true. That's true. I'm sorry, people. I have to tell you this. If they were teaching us the Word of God, how to walk on water, how to speak to the rock, well, then that'd be different. My grandmother, she was a pioneer teacher. She taught school when they didn't have any other books but the Bible. They might have had a law book. They might have had some, one arithmetic book that then they would write out. Teacher would write on the board. And then all the students would write on their little pads, eraser pads, because they didn't have paper. You with me?
Yeah.
But primarily what she taught, she was the daughter of a Quaker preacher. Quakers believed in teaching people the Bible. It was more important than teaching them anything else. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Praise God.
Amen.
She could teach them about the Civil War because Grandpa was a preacher in the Civil War. Bible in one hand, gun in the other. Didn't use the gun, used the Bible. But you had to have a gun to be in the regiment. Hallelujah. I mean, his thing was getting people to give their life to Jesus before they breathed out their last breath, if he could catch them before they died. Think about it. So she could teach about Civil War. She was a descendant of the Revolutionary War, because great-great-grandpa fought in the Revolutionary War. So she didn't really need to have anybody tell her how to teach kids about the Revolutionary War and how to teach kids about Civil War, American history. You see what I'm saying? And the things that the pilgrims went through. I mean, those are the kinds of people you interview to write the book. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
Hey, we've drifted far from that. Somebody said, no, I just believe what's really true. You don't believe what's really true. You believe what you think is really true. Because somehow you were convinced it's really true. And then you take that and you have tried to evaluate the scripture and you try to evaluate the life that God has given us to live and you can come up with the wrong conclusion. You're going to have to sell out to the Word of God being truth. The Word of God being the Word of God and it's above all other things. Hallelujah. Ha-ha-ha-prasitia. Now, when we begin to believe what's really going on in heaven, we can move with heaven. When we can really believe what God the Holy Ghost is doing, because we watch the life of Jesus and we recognize, hey, I'm living the life of Jesus. That's what I'm supposed to be doing. And that's what the Holy Ghost is going to teach me. Then I'm going to tell you right now, it doesn't matter how many disappointments you have, seemingly, how many seeming failures you have, how many times you pray and people don't get healed or whatever. You just stay right at it because you know exactly what you're supposed to be doing. You leave all the rest to Father because you don't try to interpret. You don't try to imagine. We're always imagining. We're always trying to come up with explanations. Huh? Are you listening to me?
Amen.
Hallelujah. So the Lord says, cast down the imagination. He says, bring every thought into captivity. See, God wants us to keep our hearts with all diligence. How are you going to do that? You had to get yourself baptized in the Holy Ghost. Because if you left it you to do it, you're not that diligent. You won't even know. You won't even know how to sort through which thought's good thought, which thought's bad thought. Because it's only by handling the Word that you're able to discern between good and evil. I'm not talking to you about a crisis life. I'm not talking to you about a difficult life. I'm talking to you about a life about just turning yourself completely over to the Holy Ghost, turning yourself completely over to this new creation where everything old has passed away and behold, everything is now new and of God. And we're now, I like to say, Elijah had a little old hedge. You know what you, forgive me.
Job.
I get it right. Job had a little old hedge. A little old hedge around him. A little hedge of protection. And Satan couldn't touch him. Are you listening to me?
Yeah.
People go warring against the devil. Just all kinds of crazy. Well, he doesn't merit attention. He just merits to be rebuked at most.
and cast out. Huh? I've never felt the manifest presence of God and cooperate with the Holy Ghost, because experience the manifest presence of God is a moment in time where you cooperate with the Holy Ghost. When you agree with God's word, when you agree with what God's doing. I've never experienced the manifest presence of the Lord complaining, being all caught up in the problem, getting all downcast, and you know, you're listening to me. Yes. Howling at the moon kind of thing. Yep. Complaining that God isn't doing enough or whatever. Somehow the devil's taking over. No, God, what are we going to do? I've found that if I just praise Him and worship Him and give thanks to Him and recognize that He is God and that He is in charge and Christ Jesus is Lord of lords and King of kings, that the manifest presence of the Lord begins to overwhelm me, I find myself agreeing with God and suddenly I get to move in the Holy Ghost that is going to bring the change and going to bring the remedy. That's the realm of faith. Fear don't work there. I begin to agree with all that God is doing. Come on, people. Job had a little old hedge. Huh?
He got the Holy Ghost.
Job had a little old hedge. He just had a little old hedge. But we've been baptized in the Holy Ghost and in fire. Amen. We've been baptized and immersed down in to God Almighty. Come on. God Almighty. Domasita lomopaka, the living God who rules over all things. Come on, man. We've got a few angels standing guard around us. Look, a few angels standing guard. God commissioned a couple angels, guard tree of life. That's all He needed. Take care of all humanity. You with me?
Yeah.
Are you with me? He protected the tree of life against all humanity. Just a couple, give me a couple cherubims down there. Take care of that. He didn't leave us to the angels to take care of us. God came, filled us. I said, God, the living God. I'm talking about life of God, which we're seeing little of because we're just basically doing it the way the world is doing it. We're thinking, fashioning ourselves after the rudiments of tradition, after the philosophies of the world, and we're being spoiled as a result because we're not being fashioned after the ways of Christ Jesus. Spoiled. Remember what Paul said? That's what he said. So here I'm just talking to you today about thinking different. Hallelujah. You have the mind of Christ. Did you know that? You have the mind of Christ. Somebody said, are you sure? Absolutely. 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 16, after the Lord got finished talking about all those great things, that you now could see what I have not seen, hear what ears have not heard, understand what's never entered in the heart of man because the Holy Ghost has come to reveal it to you. And when you pair that up with the fact of John chapter 16, that the Holy Ghost has come to lead you and guide you in all truth and transmit to you everything that belongs to the Father, everything that belongs to the Lord Jesus. Hello. Hello, talk about some spirit knowledge. Talk about power and authority to speak to the rock. Have a spirit knowledge to be able to speak to your financial crisis, to be able to speak to the disaster that Satan's trying to work around you in your family, in your job, in your situation, in your circumstances, to speak to those hindrances that come against you to prevent you from being who God has made you to be. Spirit knowledge. This says, oh, I see it now. I've been cooperating with a lie, a stinking lie. I've been being mastered by an imagination, a phantom that has nothing to do with reality. No wonder no prayer seemingly getting through, because all I'm sitting over here is talking a bunch of nonsense in the name of Jesus. Are you listening to me? I hope you're getting happy. Hallelujah. I know about spirit knowledge that applies specifically to what's going on in your life. Hallelujah. Speaking of the rock, so water can come out was specifically what was happening in Moses' life at the time. It's supposed to come over and cause us to realize, wait a minute, we've got the same authority if we get the knowledge. If we'll go after wisdom, if we'll go after knowledge, if we'll go after understanding with everything that is within us. And it's not some intellectual ideology fashioned by man to serve man's system, to make a slave out of you, a civilized slave. Some of the things go on in modern society, I'd rather have been a slave in former years. You'd have had more freedom. And I'm not going to get too much into breaking that down. I might lose your attention. You're going to have to get yourself some spirit knowledge so that you're not imprisoned by it, not chained by it. Huh? You're not told, this is what you're going to do. This is how you're going to live. This is the amount of influence you're going to have. There's the amount of finances you're going to have. You can't have anything else because of some explanation. Nonsense. Every one of God's people will have their own businesses and be through the top and then not be a business that consumes them, but a business that allows them freedom to go preach the gospel. Hallelujah. If you got an idea of creating a business that's going to consume you, that was a vain imagination. Cast it down. Hallelujah. But if you start getting after God, He'll give you spirit knowledge, show you how to create wealth and create finances. Don't slow you down a minute. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Woo! God don't even need money. He just needs faith. Hallelujah. God just needs faith, and He won't have you out there looking for a handout. He'll have you blessing the nations while you're going. Hallelujah. Are you listening to me? Praise God. And praise God. There's so much finances floating around doing nothing. There's too many people who got over $100 million in the bank. And they're doing nothing with it. God's people begin to cry out to God and begin to move in faith and begin to have spirit knowledge, begin to speak to that situation. So much finances will open up to resource God's people to run to 3 billion people. 3 billion people. The harvest is great and the laborers are few. And the way that we have created our systems in the Western world is all about preventing God's people from rising up and going. But rather, it's got to the point, made slaves out of both mom and dad. Go work all day, try to keep up with the debts to pay, you know, the bills and the debts that are over their head just to live a normal everyday life. You listening to me?
Yeah.
Then we can go vote into office. People are going to make that worse. It's time to hit our knees. It's time to get some spirit knowledge instead of some CNN knowledge. Instead of some Fox News knowledge. Huh? Huh? Drudge knowledge, God forbid. Huh? Spin out of your mind knowledge. You know what I'm saying? More spin than you've ever had before. Listen to us. Can you hear me? Someone say, you anti this, anti this. No, I'm pro God. I'm pro God's word. I'm saying God's word is truth, and that's it. And it's the only one that can be truth. Categorically, it's truth, and outside of His word, there is none. All men are. Come on, it's not hard to say. All men are. I'm going to say it real soft. Okay, just say it real soft. Be real gentle. God said men are liars. God's true. Jesus said, all that came before me were thieves and liars. I'm the truth and the life and the way. No man comes to the Father. No man steps into reality. No man steps into life forevermore but by me. My word is truth. Jesus is the living word. He's the living truth. And the written word from Genesis 1:1 to Revelation 22:21 is all about Him. He said, behold, I come in the volume of the book. It's written of me. To do thy will, O God. Hallelujah. And that's how we're supposed to fashion ourselves. That's how we're supposed to be taught. My goodness, what would it look like if we would take our children and put them in Holy Ghost meetings instead of in education systems that basically are nothing more than cooperating with mind-blinding spirits to corrupt their minds. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 3. They have corrupted their minds that they would be deceived as Satan beguiled Hava or Eve, and that their minds now being corrupted or darkened to where the truth is now hidden from them, having their minds corrupted from the simplicity which is in Christ. Go read it. I'm quoting it accurately. Somebody told me not too long ago, I said, you're a phenomenon. I said, why? It's because you get up there and just preach the word. And I said, that's very sad. I pray that what your observation is wrong. I pray that everywhere you go, everybody's just talking the word and processing the word and teaching people how to talk the word and process the word. And the only thing else that we even talk about or point out is to exemplify to others where we're not living under the rule of His word. God led them into the wilderness so that they may learn to live by the word of God. They may learn that man does not live by bread alone, but by every word which proceeds out of the mouth of God. And you know what? Jesus, having all knowledge, Jesus being the living word, could have said anything to Satan on that day. He could have said, anything. He quotes Deuteronomy chapter 8, verse 10. He says, man should not live by, verse 3, I always look to reference. Man should not live by word, by bread alone, but by every word which proceeds out of the mouth of God. He shut Satan down. Shut him down. One of the things, and I like to tell people about this, one of the things I like about prayer and fasting, I was just talking to a dear brother, man, a wonderful man of God, about this yesterday, is that you go and you shut everything off in your life. You shut off television, radio, your newspaper, your everything, your Facebook, yeah, even Facebook too. Everything. Which is probably more important than shutting off the food. Just the food helps you to remember to keep it shut off. And now you got to sit there and deal with all the stuff that you've taken into your thinking. Because you get real quiet now. No CDs playing with your favorite worship music either. Shut it all off. Nothing to distract you from what's really going on inside of you that's actually keeping you from spirit knowledge. Can you hear me?
Yes.
I'm telling you the truth.
Yeah.
I'm talking to you. I'm talking about people who want to go shake this world.
Yeah.
I know about the battlefield, and if you approach it wrong, you'll get taken down. But if you approach it right, not one hair will fall from your head. Not one of David's mighty men were taken in battle or killed in battle. Not one. They did it right. Except for the one that David himself betrayed. David's one great crime, one great sin, the one time when his hands shed innocent blood. But otherwise, and of course that's the only way it happens, God's people are only taken down through betrayal from within the ranks. You know what I'm saying? Christ Jesus couldn't be taken down from somebody without side of the ranks. There had to be a Judas. Has to be somebody within the ranks. I look at Judas as just nothing more, and I'm going to say this just to help you understand this, is nothing more than a personification of what Satan, Lucifer, did to God in the eons in the past. Close, intimate companion betrays him and deceives angels that stood before the presence of the Lord for eons. But we're no match for them. You better get yourself over the truth. Because deception's on the rise. But we can know the truth, and the truth will set us free. God, the Holy Ghost, has come to lead us and guide us in all truth. And unless we hold fast to the Word of God and to the truth, we will be easily corrupted. And what will happen? Our minds will be blinded. Right? What? 2 Corinthians chapter 3. Their minds were blinded. Why? Because they didn't retain the knowledge of God. Romans 1:28, they refused to continue in the knowledge of God, and he gave them over to a corrupt mind, a reprobate mind. Huh? I talked about Israel, and I also talked about Israel is referred to because of their blindness of heart state in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, also referred to the individual human people. I mean, just normal, everyday people, Romans 1:28. Think about that. Mind-blinding spirits, various different degrees in which you give yourself over to mind-blinding spirits, which you can look in 1 Corinthians chapter 2 and verse 14 and see that state of the unredeemed mind, that state where your mind is darkened, where you're blinded to spirit knowledge, that state cannot receive the things of the Holy Ghost. Can't receive that which God wants to give to us. People, we're going to have to get ourselves a clear line between good and evil, between God and Satan, between truth and lie. If we just go after it, if we just set our heart to it, if we just consecrate ourselves to it, I'm telling you right now, God will help us. God will establish us. God will make these things. God, the Holy Ghost, will make these things that they absolutely rule our lives. You're going to have to start giving yourself to reading the Word. You're going to have to give yourself continually to reading the Word every day. And it shouldn't be a chore. It should be a delight for its spirit and life. John chapter 6 and verse 63, My word, he says, the flesh profiteth nothing. Hallelujah. It's the Holy Ghost that makes alive and quickens or gives insight. Huh? My word is spirit and life. So when you're reading the Bible, it's not, you may not hardly understand a lot of it. But you know what? Something's working on the inside of you. His word's working mightily in them that believe. You hear me? His word begins to work on effectually in those that believe. Hallelujah. Woo. It begins to produce a roposhikana, faith, spirit, knowledge, faith, hatasa, so that as we have believed, so we also may now speak. What? Just speak out of our own thinking realm? Speak out of the spirit. Speak out of the spirit realm. It's spirit knowledge. It's God the Holy Ghost speaking. It's hearing what Father has to say and speaking it. Seeing the Father always before us. Come on now. These things, these are great mantles, these are great giftings, these are great opportunities that by and large have been left to lay because people have gone over here and pursued fame and other interests and monetized God. Can you imagine monetizing God? Reducing all this glory to something that's purely monetary, has a monetary interest. Come on, people. We're blessed with all spiritual blessings in the heavenly realm.
Hallelujah.
Doesn't say we're blessed with all earthly blessings in an earthly realm. Huh? We're blessed with all spiritual blessings in the heavenly realm. That's all Elijah needed to live on.
Thank you.
Hey, listen to me. Boy, he's living good, ain't he?
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We're blessed with all spiritual blessings in the heavenly realm. Hallelujah. Woo. That's all the children of Israel needed to live on. You know how many? 3 million? Even 1 million, but let's just say it was 3 million because that's a pretty good number based upon the general consensus of those who I consider knows. Hallelujah. That's a lot of people to feed out in the desert. Oh, listen to me. Spiritual blessings and all heavenly places, it's enough to take care of everybody's needs. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
I want his riches. I want the riches that he has. He who is rich became poor for my sake, that through his poverty I might be made rich. Amen. Seated with him in a heavenly realm, being able now to speak out of this realm of divine power and glory. I know this anointing might be too much for some of you. Just get used to it. You'll get comfortable. A lot of times I hold babies for a while, they start crying. And it ain't because I'm speaking loud. It's because there's something going on in my life. It's a little different from what their little spirit's used to. Are you listening to me? And we just hold them for a while and then they get happy. Don't go get up and run just because things are a little uncomfortable. Say, somebody said, oh, it's not comfortable for me. I guarantee you, if you sell your TV and give it away, that won't be comfortable for you either. Let me say that a little louder. Because you become addicted to certain ways, certain thinking, certain processes, certain feels, certain ideas, certain ways of living. And then when all of a sudden you're shown another way, that's uncomfortable. That feels weird. This ain't flowing. This ain't working. Huh? Are you listening to me now? Hallelujah. Praise God. The real important issue is what I'm saying the Word of God? Is what I'm saying what God's called us to do? The real issue is, are you living in the Spirit? If you are alive in the Spirit, you're supposed to be moving with the Holy Ghost. Huh? Galatians 5:25. I'm going to tell you the Word of God. I'm not going to isolate little pieces and parts to suit my own interest or my own ideas. I'm going to give you the counsel of God. I'm going to give you the whole counsel of God. I'm going to start again reading Genesis 1:1 and read all the way through Revelation 22:21. Somebody said, I read the Bible once and it's supposed to impress me. Big deal. I didn't understand a single word I read when I read the Bible the first time. Not a single word. What I did get, I just accepted. You know what I'm saying? But this is how God forms us. This is how he molds us. This is how he shapes us. This is how the Holy Ghost reaches up and slaps us and says, don't do that no more. Because you're reading the Bible from Genesis 1:1 to Revelation 22:21. Somebody said, well, I did that. You say I got to start again? Well, we want to get you past that. We want to get you to the place of, oh, yeah, man, I'm ready to go. I'm ready to go for it again, you know. What's your threshold in the Word? What's your threshold of watching movies? What's your threshold of being in the Word? Have you learned how to interact with spirit knowledge? Have you learned how to feast upon the Word of God? Have you learned how to commune at the table of the Master? Have you learned how to get filled up there? His Word become your delight? Hallelujah. Not just the ones you like. Not just your daily bread verse of Scripture for the week. I'm talking about being saturated. Woo! Saturated with the Word. You know, Wigglesworth, I love Wigglesworth, a great example of moving in faith. And he said there would come a time where people would get so hooked up. And he talked about different moves of God that would come. And he said there would be a time when people get so hooked up with the Word of God and with the anointing of the Holy Ghost, there would be a great explosion of revival. And it's about time, people, that we give ourselves to the Word. People, if you got stuff wearing you out where you don't have time, as soon as you get around the things of the Spirit of God, you start getting tired and sleepy, that's a manifestation of some problem that has a cure. Isn't it good?
Yeah.
It ain't good. Every problem, God's got a cure. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let's just let God readjust our lives. Let God readjust your life. As we're down in 2016 in this new year, make sure that everything belonging to the Spirit of God and the things of the kingdom of God central to your life. Come on, people. Come on in. Let the same zeal that was on Josiah be on you. Times being baptized in the Holy Ghost, who began to understand the will of God and rose up with a passion and a zeal and started tearing everything down and chopping everything up in his life and in his world and in his kingdom that was not of God. You don't need an iPhone that much. You don't need a computer that much. You don't need an iPad that much. If you do not have enough Holy Ghost to say no to demonic lies, then get yourself in a cave till you do. Lock yourself in a room, fast and pray, and I guarantee you. I've had so many people say, oh, I want things to change. I want them to be different. I had a man of God come to me one time, and I cast the devil out of him. I mean, I truly did. I'm not exaggerating. I cast the devil out of him. He said, I want to get this thing right. I want to walk right with God. I said, no problem. You serious? You want to get this thing right? You want to get established with God? Why don't you stop eating? I'll give you a place to stay. You go fast and pray. Well, he didn't want to get that right that bad. He wanted to get right without having to fast. Well, you don't want to get right that bad then, do you? I can't break this problem. I can't break this habit. I get right for a while, and I go right back to it. I got your solution, man. You got yourself a stronghold working in your spirit. You got yourself a stronghold. Cast down imaginations. And strongholds. And bring into captivity every thought. And say this. Evaluate it. Is this spirit knowledge? Is this the knowledge of Christ Jesus? Is this declared to us what the living Word showed us and what the written Word tells us? If not, you're not allowed here. I'm not going with you. Because what happens is the way that our minds will play tricks on us and the way things work is we'll start making decisions out of a realm that has nothing to do with God, the Holy Ghost, His Word, and it won't even be up for analysis. And we will go right on in this thing, and we think that we're right, and we'll see all these problems, and it's not working out. It's just one thing after another, and we don't recognize that we could just stop and shut down and say, wait a minute, we're not doing it right. We got a great teacher here to help us. If you were doing it so wrong on your job, you'd get fired, you know it. You know what I'm saying? You just shut down and say, okay, Holy Ghost, I want spirit knowledge. I'm going to take what God says in His Word in the Proverbs, pursuing knowledge and wisdom and understanding, and recognize that we're talking about the knowledge of the holy, the understanding of the living God. Did you know the phrase word of knowledge is only found One time in the Bible? One time. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 8. One time. The words of knowledge, that phrase, words of knowledge, are found twice in the Bible, both in Proverbs. The rest, the concept, is based upon simply the knowledge of God. Where does that come from? The Word of God. And so we've got all these crazy things that I believe are more the activity of a familiar spirit. I'm telling you, that are more the activity of a familiar spirit than it is of God being spoken of supposedly as words of knowledge. It's not words of knowledge. It's not the Bible. I can tell you a word of knowledge sounds just like the Word of God. And the results of it will cause you to do what the Word of God tells you to do. Why I say it's a spirit knowledge, why I say it's a familiar spirit, first of all, it's spirit knowledge. Second of all, many of these words of knowledge causes people to ultimately have actions and do things that are contrary to what God says in His Word. Creates division, creates strife, creates rebellion, causes people to leave churches, causes people to seek their own thing, go get off course with God. Over and over again, I can tell you. Accept wrong things, wrong ideas, wrong lifestyle, wrong living. So, you know what? The fruit declares the root, doesn't it? It does. Fruit declares the root. Everybody, I want you to stand with me, please. I'm going to pray over you because I recognize in this place I've got a bunch of hungry hearts. I recognize in this place I've got people who want to do it right and get it right. I want you to understand that Father's got a purpose for you, and it's bigger than your 401. It's bigger than your retirement plan. It's bigger than the vocation that you have. It's bigger than you being fervent in business. It's bigger than you providing for your own. I just really, you know, I find it humorous how many people wrestle the scripture of their own destruction and take one isolated scripture that says that he that does not provide for his own is worse than an infidel and has denied the faith, and utilizes that verse of scripture now to, as it were, make 1,000 verses of scripture none effect. You're supposed to understand that verse of scripture in view of seek first the kingdom of God. Take no thought for what you should eat. Take no thought for what you should wear. And if you analyze it, look at it in the right perspective, then it'll make sense, and you won't now all of a sudden just forget about walking in the way that God has purposed for us to live and live out our lives as He leads us, and go over here and deny the faith. Huh? Being consumed with all the workload and all the other issues. Oh, sabate rista bokande ishte kinema. Don't get me wrong. I'm not saying that you need to leave your job. You can be an evangelist at your job. But being an evangelist at your job takes priority. If they tell you to be quiet, you say, I'm not going to be quiet. Say, somebody told me one day, said, oh, you can't wear a shirt like that here at the work, at the job. Because I had a white t-shirt. It was an appropriate white t-shirt. It wasn't see-through. And it said, Jesus saves, big red letters, front. Back, it says, His blood cleanses us. I was a walking banner. Somebody said, you can't wear that shirt. I say nothing. I just continue to wear a shirt. Jesus first. People's lives have got to matter. The reality of heaven and hell and eternity has got to come. It's got to matter. It's got to be real to us, people. Huh? That which has been made available to us. Signs, wonders, and miracles to be. Signs and wonders. Hallelujah. We live as signs and wonders. You and me, we live as signs and wonders. You and we, this is who we are. We another race. We need to quit acting like we are mere men. We belong to another race. Hallelujah. Come, banda si patara hoshi. Manda. Quit feeling inferior. That's part of fear. Huh? You're in charge now. Hallelujah. I got some more to talk about along these lines tonight, so if you want to understand a little bit more about how to move in spirit knowledge, come back. Let's just go ahead and live fully for Jesus. If your doctrine does not allow you to live fully for Jesus, I'm going to tell you, get yourself another doctrine. Hallelujah.
What you believe about God doesn't allow you to live fully in Him. Come on now. Start believing what He reported, because the report of the Lord is glorious. Praise God. The anointing of the Holy Ghost is here. Is there anybody in this place you've never called upon the name of Jesus? It's the sweetest name I know. It's the greatest power that exists. It's greater power than U.S. government. It's greater power than the European Union. Huh? It's greater power than any power or force on in heaven and earth. Hallelujah. The name of Jesus. All you got to do is call upon the name of Jesus, and with a sincere heart, I'm telling you, heaven will be mobilized, Holy Ghost to come upon you and change you into another person. I mean, He'll take you just like He took Saul, and He'll anoint you with a great boldness and an authority to go from hiding in the stuff to striking terror in the hearts and the eyes of men. Hallelujah. Somebody said, aren't you afraid of the Taliban? Aren't you afraid of the Pashtuns? No, when I come, peace comes with me. When I come, love comes with me. Hallelujah. Well, I watched some program and they said they how mean they were. Well, if somebody was hunting you down with a gun, you'd pretty retaliate too. You know what I'm saying? And there's bad things they've done. Don't get me wrong. There's bad things they've done. There's bad things everybody's done. That ain't stopped God. Hallelujah. When we were enemies by wicked works, He commended His love towards us, man. Praise God for that. Praise God for that. Praise God for that. He didn't say, they down there just acting evil, raping and killing and pillaging and murdering and lying and cheating. Forget them. He said, I love them. I'm going to redeem them from that mess. Amen. He told me, come follow Him. Told you, come follow Him. And when we follow Him, I'm telling you right now, things begin to change. Today, if you're not following Jesus, you're not even alive. The scripture says, he that has the Son has life. And he that does not have the Son does not have life. And John emphasizes the Son message because he sees you and I in Christ Jesus, the Son, and calls us sons because we are one. This is the message. Somebody said, why didn't he just come out with it and say, he that has Jesus Christ has life? Because he's gone and united us in this brotherhood, united us in the family, united us in the things that Christ Jesus has done for us. Let me give you some good spirit knowledge as I'm calling you to salvation, as I'm calling you to repentance, as I'm calling you to consecration. Let me give you some good spirit knowledge over here. I know how you can hear God say to you every day, well done, my good and faithful servant. Wouldn't you like to have that spirit knowledge to hear God say that to you? I know how to do it. I know how to transmit it to you right at this very moment. I hope this is exciting to you because, listen to me, I'm going to show you right now. And I'm glad that you're interested because I can feel it. When you come to understand that you do not exist outside of Christ Jesus. When you make your life in Him, when He lives in you and you live in Him, you hear every day Father saying what He said to His only begotten Son, this is my beloved Son, whom I'm well pleased. You hear Him say every day, well done, my good and faithful servant. Whatever Father's saying to Jesus, woo, I get to hear it every day. Somebody say, you mean I got to read the Bible? Yeah, this is what happens when you read the Bible. This kind of stuff you get out of it. You find your whole life and existence and meaning within the context of Christ Jesus. Now in the name of the living God, I destroy every mind-blinding spirit, every word of men that has hidden in the darkness the counsels of God. You don't obey God, I'm going to tell you right now, you don't do God's way, you're not going to have God's provision. And people get so stuck within the imaginations and in the strongholds that they never break through free to begin to live in the abundance of Christ Jesus. Do not self-justify. Let God's word justify you, Christ Jesus. Be willing to bow low to His word and to the instructions of the Holy Ghost. Quit going it on your own, doing it on your own. If it's not working out, be wise enough to recognize that there are adjustments and changes that you need to make in your life. Quit doing the same thing and expect that somehow you're going to have change. Start doing it God's way. I'm telling you, He invites us to come in to a place of brokenness and humility before Him. Jesus said, come and learn of me. I'm meek and I'm lowly. Here, if you'll learn lowliness, if you'll learn meekness, this is what God the Holy Ghost is teaching. If you learn submission, if you learn brokenness before Him and before those things of the kingdom, then all of His riches and all His provision will flow freely to you. And all the works that He desires to do and all the promotion, how He would set you up on high, will begin to be made manifest. Don't miss out on Jesus. Do not leave this place without consecrating your life fully to live for Him. Because God the Holy Ghost sees it. The Lord says, yea, I know when you sit down, and I know when you rise up, and I even know your thoughts from far away. And He's just saying, if you're going to decide with me, I will decide with you. If you will yield to me, I will cause all that I have to flow to you. Today, decide that you're going all the way with the Lord. No more half measures. Consecrate yourself to His ways. Consecrate yourself to the things of the Word and to the Spirit of God. And I promise you, you'll begin to live days of heaven upon the earth. For in the Old Testament, Deuteronomy chapter 11, if they could live days of heaven upon the earth under the first covenant, now that you and I stand in this more glorious covenant, you listen very carefully to me because you need to hear this, because changes need to take place in your life. I'm going to tell you, this is what always challenges people, because I tell them, you have to have radical change. And that's where it kind of starts breaking down, because people want to go on with the same processes of thinking, with the same actions and the same attitudes. Today, I'm calling you. I want to be very clear with you what I'm saying. I'm calling you to giving yourself to radical change, measurable change that is described to you by the Word of God that causes you to think different, because it's God the Holy Spirit. It's God the Holy Spirit that gives you the power to keep your heart with all diligence. For out of it proceeds the issues of life. Out of it proceeds what you're going to declare. Huh? Hallelujah. What you're going to agree with. Today, decide for Jesus. If there's anyone in this place and you've never called upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ that resulted in the Holy Ghost coming upon you, that resulted in a new heart and a new spirit, a change of attitude, a change of desire, a change of passion, a change of appetite, a change of direction to live for the kingdom instead of living for your own life, then He's calling you to come. Whether you're here in this place, you're watching me by web or watching me by YouTube, I tell you, the simple calling upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ will change the atmosphere of your life. That will be the beginning. So that now God the Holy Ghost can take you for the rest of your life, and every day, and if you're willing, every second of every day, and every minute of every day, and every hour of every day, shape you, change you, develop you into all the ways and the nature, the appetites of God. All you have to do is be willing. You decide. It all comes down to a decision. Heaven or hell? The earthly realm or the heavenly realm? The things that belong to death or the things that belong to life? Why don't you choose life today and live? Amen. Why don't you choose obedience to God today and live? Yes. Why don't you choose to walk with the Holy Spirit today and live? Anyone, we invite you to come. Anyone. Anyone. We'll pray with you and for you, and God will change you. Yes. And I'm going to say then to everyone, and once again, those watching by web or by YouTube, right now, just call upon the name of the Lord Jesus. He's right there. Wherever you're at, whatever situation you're in, I don't care if you're in prison or in an ivory palace, it does not matter. You start saying, Jesus, come help me. Jesus, come change me. I'm telling you, just do it. Do it. And the atmosphere of your life, the atmosphere of the room that you're in, I don't care where you're at, it will change. You can be driving in your car. You can be standing on the beach. It does not matter. Just begin to say, Jesus, come help me. Jesus, come change me. That's all it takes. It's the power of His name. Hallelujah. Now I want to just ask every one of you to raise your hands towards heaven. The psalmist said, Let the lifting of my hands be as the evening sacrifice, the morning and the evening sacrifice. That means the lifting of your hands is an act of complete and total consecration to God. Burn me up. Let my life be turned into smoke, as it were, for your praise, to worship you. Now, Father, I thank you for touching every person with their hands lifted at this moment. Strengthening them, Father God, to understand how to walk a consecrated life, a separated life unto you, to live after those things which you've spoken in your word, written in your word, and those things which you are teaching us by the Holy Ghost. In Jesus' name, I break off every stronghold in Jesus' name. I break off every hindrance in Jesus' name. I break off every lie, every distraction in the name of Jesus. Everything that's tried to imprison you, everything that's tried to hold you back, everything that's tried to produce doubt and unbelief in your life, it's broken now in Jesus' name. Broken. Broken off you. Broken off you. Broken off you. Broken off you. And with it, your sickness and disease goes too. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Everybody give a shout. Oh, mighty God. Oh, mighty God. Woo-hoo. Lord, we praise you. Lord, we praise you. Lord, we praise you. Lord Jesus, we praise you. We thank you, Lord Jesus. We praise you. Give thanks unto you. Thank you, mighty God. Hallelujah. 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 Woohoo! Hallelujah. 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 Ha ha ha. Hallelujah! Woo! Well, listen. Honor the Lord with your substance, with all the first fruits of your increase. Just recognize that as you give, as you participate with Father in the miracle through giving, Father's going to multiply again unto you. And so honor the Lord with your tithes, honor him with the offering. Always do that. Find a bunch of people around you. Hug them. Tell them that you love them. Bless them in the name of Jesus. Don't hold back what God wants to do through you. And if anybody needs prayer for anything, you need prayer, you got sickness or disease in your body, torment in your mind, some harassing things going on, we're here to pray with you and for you. We know God will touch you. So right now, go find a bunch of people. Hug them. Bless them. Tell them that you love them. Let the power of God flow through you. Somebody said, I just really want more love in my life. Well, then cooperate with love. You know what I'm saying? Hallelujah. Poco roshitambale yashikota. Hallelujah. Mande risando kurishte balataya. Mange na da mancheste. Mande la koyapra. Mande la sitaya. Hallelujah. Mange la mangesi pratushi. Hallelujah. Manda bre mande riviste di la costa. Menenda la bocoste brede kiste peya. Mananda de bebreveya. Mandanda de bebreveya. Shistaya haya. Hallelujah. Marama mamanda kiyana namosita tu yarushika. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. We're here to pray with anybody who wants prayer, needs prayer, sickness in your body, torment in your mind. Doesn't matter. Maybe you've not been baptized in the Holy Ghost. We want to see you baptized in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. God wants it for your life. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Pro dasi karaneya. Hallelujah. Just let the Spirit of the Lord overwhelm you right now. That the sparanaya. Spotoranesh te pokorini fiala. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. What do you want, my dear sister? What do you want Jesus to do?
Salvation to my children and Iraqi people.
Okay. Father, we thank you that you promised us that not only would we be saved, but also a house. Look at me. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, by the power of the Most High God, faith overwhelms you to call them into the kingdom.
So right now in Jesus' name, we call them into the kingdom. Sambrandaya, every mind-blinding spirit, we break off of them. We turn them from the power of Satan to the power of God right now. We turn them from darkness to life right now. We open up the eyes of the blind right now that they might receive forgiveness of sin and inheritance with all the saints of God. Hallelujah. Manjasitai. Now you just be strengthened and be refreshed right now. Hallelujah. Leste remande. Leste remandostai. Leristaka romondast. Mandele ashebri. That's right. Just receive. Let that glory of heaven overwhelm your soul right now. Just receive. There you go. Hallelujah. Heristine. Heristana. Habast. Just take hold of God right now. Feast on heaven. Hallelujah. Feast on heaven. Mandastakiri. Mestikirinai. Blessed. Be blessed right now. Hey, how are you doing? You're back. It's good to see you. Have you turned your life over to Jesus? That is awesome. That is awesome. That is a miracle. Praise God. Father, I thank you that your daughter's going to enjoy everything about the kingdom of God that there is to enjoy right now in Jesus' name. I command you in Jesus' my name, be filled with the Holy Ghost. Ha, ha, ha. Be filled with the good things of heaven. And right out of your belly, hallelujah. My goodness, you're not a Hindi anymore. You're part of the kingdom of God. Isn't that good? Hallelujah. Lord, I pray that all Sri Lanka be saved. All Sri Lanka be saved. Ha! All Sri Lanka come into the kingdom. Siponde, all Sri Lanka, hallelujah. Mongjashe, have a great visitation of heaven, that their eyes be opened to the glory of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, that the glory of heaven and the power of the Holy Ghost overwhelms every part of their life in Jesus' name. Monzistala, Mesde Kondo, Merenjesi stai, Lerinanjo stai. Now, out of your belly flows these rivers of the Holy Ghost. Right now, Isetolai, Irisondo, Irishambrekai, Librasoto, Librasoto. Just receive what he wants to give you.
Yes, Lord.
Just receive what he wants to give you.
Librabositeya,
Mandandelepeya, Mandandelesht. Great peace, great joy. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus. Lord Jesus, we thank you.
Lord Jesus, we renounce all other gods and we call them demons. That's radical, you know, for people been raised in Hinduism, 33 million gods, or Buddhism. Huh? This is nothing more than animism. Eh? The worship of more than that, because every blade of grass, every leaf on the tree, you see? You know what I'm saying? Becomes a part of deity and gods. Eh? But they all devils, all lies, trying to hide the truth of Jesus Christ, the truth of the living God who loves us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Just say it with me. Say, I renounce. Just say it with me. Say, I renounce all other gods as demons and lies, and accept Jesus Christ alone as the only living God. Whoa.
Ale maje, ale maje tane.
No, that's huge. Huge. Someone raised in Hinduism. It's a miracle. And Father's going to cause you to understand, see, the reality of His goodness and who He is. And you're not going to take it for granted like many Westerners do. You're going to jump in head first. Hallelujah. Begin to enjoy all the good things of heaven. In Jesus' name. And you too. You're going to jump in head first too.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. And you too. And you too. Brosata. In Bastanea. In the name of Jesus, the thoughts change. I break off these old harassing, tormenting thoughts that have become strongholds. Satan, you take your hands off the property of God. I paint you right now with the blood of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Boris.
Jesus. The Lord wants to so touch you, make you so sensitive, the slightest wind of the Spirit blows you over. True. God wants to make it to where that it's not an act, it's not a pretend, that you just so give yourself to Him that the slightest moving of God, the Holy Ghost, knocks you flat. You learn, so he said, how do I do that? You start agreeing with God. Every time you agree with God and you disagree with everything else, you become all the more sensitive to the moving of the Spirit of the living God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. This is what Father wants for you. It's a joy life. In the name of Jesus, I command you to get so filled with the things of heaven, you don't have room for the things of this world. To be so full of the Holy Ghost, there's no room for the influence of demon spirits. Somebody said, can I make heaven with sin in my life? Why would you want to? You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Should I say that again? Somebody, can I make heaven with sin in my life? Why would you want to?
Amen.
The beauty of heaven's come to fill us with every good thing. Why would you want any hell in your life? Yeah. We're talking heaven.
Yeah.
Can't have heaven when you got hell. Dear people, we want you to get busy around you helping people. Okay? Loving on them. Being there for them. Find people around you to take care of and to mentor. Everybody has some people. And grab. I'll tell you right now, if I wasn't pastoring and running nations of the world, I have all kinds of people to be mentoring. Loving on them. Take them to, do stuff. Come on now. Showing them how to walk this walk with God. Don't ruin your life by spending it on yourself. Can I say it another way? Don't waste your life spending it on yourself. Please. Did you hear? Don't waste your life spending it on yourself. Whatever you want, just take it in Jesus' name. Just start doing it with God. And don't you get sad for a minute trying to figure out how it's going to work out. Huh? But why don't you just go ahead and have spirit knowledge and know that the Lord's working. Hallelujah. And when you know He's working, you're just going to get happy, you see. You can just be full of faith. Because what God said is, you call, I'll answer. Huh? Now we need a couple of people on the earth believe that. So we get something done. Now then that's what you're going to do. Now in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, there's going to be no harassing, torment, things mess with faith in your life. Amen. Nor you either. Holy women of God. We got too many places to send people to the mission field. And you can't go there unless you're full of faith.
Yeah.
Otherwise you'd die or something. You'd die or get burned out. Hallelujah. Just receive, girls. Just receive. Just take hold of God. Just take hold of Him right now. Lift your hand towards Him. Just take hold of God. Just receive right now. Don't wait for a lightning bolt to strike you. Just receive. There's enough anointing for you to get everything you need. Just receive. So easy to be filled with God's love and His life. All I got to do is just cooperate with it. Just do it. Instead of waiting for it to come, just recognize it is. You know, the scripture says, without faith it's impossible to please God, for those that come to Him must believe that He is. Well, you know, that's the exist word. That's the be word, to be. And it literally means, if I want to translate it properly, you must believe that He is, and He's here. Say, He is,
yes.
And He's here.
He's here.
He's with me and in me.
Yes.
Lift your hands towards heaven. Here you go, Bob. Hallelujah. Say, He is.
He is.
And He's here.
And He's here.
Yeah. Amen. Amen. Well, find
another 1,000 people and hug them. And we'll see you tonight. Hallelujah.